So yeah, okay. The first thing I want to do is just go over some admin things, and then we'll get into the material. So yeah, reminder. So we're doing screencasts. One thing I had thought about doing is, as we get into doing these assignments and gearing up towards the the class projects, it might be nice to try to have sort of like when we assign readings or something, or assign projects, maybe people might be interested in doing sort of mini presentations along. Along the way over these next few weeks. Would that be something, like, do you do that constantly in other classes, sort of present work along the way? Might be a nice way to kind of prototype. Let's keep that in the back of our minds, and when we go over the assignment later today, we can talk about that. Okay, so we also, some office hour stuff, so I got just a few responses about people's availabilities. I imagine everyone's sort of crisscrossed hours. There was a couple people suggested that I just do them on the same day of the class. Raise your hands if you're actually free after class, after this class, each week, basically. Raise your hand if you're not free. Okay, so a few people. What about before this class? Raise your hand if you're not free. Okay, raise your hand if you're not free both right before this class and right after this class. We can, okay, that doesn't mean we're going to do it on this, but okay, and that's good for me to know. I'm actually going to be also starting a residency next week, which is right in the area, so it doesn't have to be done over I'd like to be able to basically spend some time with all of you, so it doesn't necessarily have to be through office hours. So if you just start emailing me about projects, we'll figure out a way to meet. And I'll be actually close by a lot. So for today, I'll stick around after for at least an hour or something. So if you have some things you wanna chat about, right after this class will be good. Okay, so course projects. So basically, starting today, we're going to start really doing stuff, seeing applications. So you can all start to think about, at least start to think about what you might be interested in doing. For the final week of projects. And I'm kind of think there's three categories of projects that would work, but I'm super open to other kinds. Again, I don't want to be dogmatic about what is and is not an interesting presentation. It's a really big topic, as everyone knows. But the most obvious one is probably doing different applications, tools, building tools and applications. So, for example, we'll be doing Weconator today. So that's a really, really great platform for creating some sort of a prototype of machine learning in the real-time performative sense. So that would make a great presentation topic. And by the end of today, you should have the sort of the rough framework of how it works. So you'd be able to even start as soon as we're done. So yeah, that's art music applications. Another thing that people might be interested in, so I spend a lot of time just building tools. So some of the Weconator tools that I'll be showing you today are OSC applications that make it easier for Weconator to communicate with various other things. If you're interested in doing things like that, that's also, I think, super valuable and also super useful because there's other people that are asking me about different applications. So that's something, yeah, we already have, we were talking about Connect to Gesture, so that's what, I'll actually be showing you guys that a little earlier, or a little later today. And then we're going to do a short section today. Again, I think more people want to do applications, but we'll do a short section today on some notes that I've collected on various issues related to machine learning and AI. And that's also I think people should consider a good project topic. So if there's something you're interested in researching and writing about and presenting, minus electricity, that's totally, that would be totally acceptable also. This what do you think is to say, if you have some other ideas, if you get really deep into a topic and you want to bring it up, please do. Because we should hopefully have a nice milieu of different sort of perspectives on machine learning and AI. So does anyone have any questions on sort of admin stuff?
Is there a GitHub with
Yeah, so at the moment there's not. I'll be sharing a lot of like links to, so there is a lot of source code, and all of the source code we'll be sharing is actually online. It's just not all in one place. In the lecture notes I'll be including all of the different GitHub links. Maybe sometime this week as we start to develop software for the course, we can start to maybe aggregate it in one place. I have to figure out exactly how that would work. But definitely at least right now to say all of the stuff we're doing, the source code exists, is on GitHub.
Okay, because I saw it last time, that's what I haven't seen yet.
Okay. What we'll do today in terms of the material, we'll kind of do a short review of just what we did last week, getting into how neural networks work, so just doing a short review of the basic idea. Then I'm going to kind of show you the basic workflow of like setting up a machine learning experiment, and we're going to use open frameworks for that. Open frameworks is not necessarily the first thing that people would use to do machine learning stuff. I think like a lot of introductory machine learning classes do this stuff in Python. And I'm going to show you some of the tools that you could use if you wanted to do that instead. It's mainly going to be conceptual, so like it'll be the same. Like we'll talk about how to set up your data, how to train, and how to apply. And I'm using Open Frameworks because I'm going to use it as a precursor to show this one tool that some of you might be interested in that I've developed, which is called Connect to Gesture. It's a gesture recognizer, and we have the Connect here. I thought that would be a fine, and also there's visuals, so that's kind of a nice way to explain the concepts. And it's quick because they're all set up. So I'm going to use Open Frameworks for that, and we're going to talk about classification, regression, and clustering. And then I'll kind of do a short review of different platforms that you could use if you wanted to set up basically vanilla ordinary neural networks. And then the most of today we'll talk about Wekinator, and we'll kind of do a bunch of demos of Wekinator stuff. And then we'll see how much time we have. We'll talk about some different readings about different issues, ethics, society, that type of stuff. Okay. Yeah? Anybody? All right. Let's review. Okay, so last week we basically learned about neural networks, and let me just pull up a browser. So I'm just going to, cool. Recall that for a, let's actually go to the figures first, sorry. So like, let's just use the basic example we worked with last week was classifying handwritten digits. So we took an image, we decomposed it into its pixel representation. We loaded the first layer of a neural network with that. And then after training the network, which we'll talk about in a little bit more detail today, we basically have something like this. So this is doing a forward pass. This is training the network, so this will take a second. And then it classifies digits, and there's 10 classifier neurons at the end of the chain here. This is a one hidden layer neural network. So if we kind of go through these, you'll see it predicts what digit it thinks it is, and usually does a pretty good job. We tried to do this with a more complicated data set, which was much more difficult. Right? So this is kind of the basic idea with neural networks. They're creating a sort of input between, a mapping between inputs, often a very complex set of inputs, and a much simpler or condensed set of outputs. So we often think about it in terms of like classification accuracy. So, you know, is this image, what class does this image belong to? But you want to start to think about it in a much more general sense. We're creating a sort of function which maps one arbitrarily sized input to one arbitrarily sized output. And this is kind of, it helps to think of it this way because when we look at, when we start to use Wekinator and do real-time performance stuff, there's not going to be any sort of like ground truth data set that we're training to. It's going to be kind of like we're training the network so that it does our bidding, you know, so it does what we want it to do. We'll show kind of how to do that. Just in terms of the review, let's just see. So we looked at the forward pass. One thing we didn't talk so much about and what is regression. So we kind of, all the examples we looked at were classification. But remember, this was the thing that we started with, right? This is the basic workflow of a neural network. And if we get rid of all the class labels and we just interpret this as a score at the end, like a continuous score that we can do this a whole bunch of times, it'll have a different score. We can use this for regression too. So imagine we're trying to predict some continuous value, and we're going to see that when we use open frameworks. This value can be interpreted as our prediction, and it has a certain amount of error away from whatever the ground truth is. So that's regression. I think we covered it briefly, and we're going to look at it now a little closer. Okay, input versus output. Mapping. Okay, so we're gonna now use Open Frameworks. So how many people used Open Frameworks before? Okay, just a few, not too many. Okay, how many people know what Open Frameworks is, or don't know what Open Frameworks is? Everyone. Okay, everyone knows it in places like this. So I'm going to show you an add-on that I work with called OFX Learn, which is an add-on for doing basically like machine learning in Open Frameworks. If you don't have Open Frameworks installed, or even if you do, you don't need to follow along. This is just going to be a high-level workflow introduction. So we're gonna look at the source, but kind of at a high level. So I'm gonna show you the first example, which is the classification example. Okay, so first let me just show you what it does, and then we'll kind of step through the code. Okay, so what I've done is I've created a random set of points belonging to three classes, blue, green, and red, and they all have two values, x and y, right? So we've plotted all of them. So each of these points has an x and a y. And the category, the colors are assigned like this. So basically, like, I made a toy training set. There are 5,000, so we do this, we add an example, 5,000 examples. And each example is a, can you see that actually? I should make this a little bigger, right? Hang on a second. Yeah, you can put that down if you'd like. I'll also make the font a bit bigger. How do you actually do that? Who knows where the size of the... I can't even find where the size of the fonts are. Anyone know in Xcode?
Command plus?
No, that doesn't do it here, actually. Yeah. You know what I'll do? I'll just do it this way. That's okay. That works just fine. Okay, so each sample is a two-digit value, or has two values, rather, and it's just a random number. And the way the labels are picked is kind of a stupid thing, where basically I measure the distance from the center, and if it's in the middle, the label is 1. If it's in the sort of middle ring, the label is 2. And if it's in the outer ring, the label is 3. But you see that there's like this sort of noise. There's a little bit of a random shuffle that I use to make it a little noisy. So like it's not actually properly assigned. They're like overlapping classes. That's just to try to trick the machine a little bit and see how it does. Because real world data sets are kind of noisy like this. So back to the code. So we make it, and then and you'll see that like almost every basic machine learning framework works like this. You get a bunch of data, you add the instances to a classifier object. So you'd see like this would be very similar in Python or other, you know, other machine learning environments. And then you train it. And then training, what it does is it does what we saw before with the digits. It tunes the weights in such a way that when you query the network and give it a new random value, it'll predict what the response should be. So if we're looking at this, it's doing this every frame. It takes my mouse point And it runs it through the machine, and then it predicts what value it would be. And you can see it kind of, it's green usually when we're in the green areas, red in the middle. That's the, you know, the dot that's kind of hovering around. So that's classification, right? So this is sort of a similar workflow, right? You add a whole bunch of examples, you hit train, and then there's going to be like a fit or predict. I have it set as predict. Sometimes you'll see it as fit or something like that. And most of the rest of this is fluff. It's just, you know, colors, color stuff. But really, there's like basically three important lines. There's this, add a training instance, which we do 5,000 times. There's this, train, and then there's predict. And then we set the color according to our prediction. It looks like this. Now, obviously, this is like a super toy example. Usually, your data sets will contain many more columns of data, so not just two, but many more, so it becomes harder to visualize. You might have a 1,000-dimensional data set or something. Okay, so that's classification. Now, I also have a regression example, which I want to show you, and we'll talk briefly about clustering. Okay, so, and there's actually, there are two, OFX Learn has two separate regression classes. One is a neural network, which is called OFX Learn MLP. That's MLP, and then SVR is a support vector machine for regression, so it's support vector regression. We won't really talk about support vector machines, but it's another algorithm for doing supervised learning. MLP stands for multi-layer perceptron, which is sort of like the original name for neural networks in the, you know, way back in the day. It's actually kind of a misnomer because perceptrons are binary, so I don't know why they're still. I think it's a lot of old things still call it MLP or multi-layer perceptron, but it's just a neural network basically with multiple layers. So in this example, we did a similar thing where we basically made 300 dots, and now we're doing it to two different ones. There's an MLP and an SVR, and we added the training instance to each one, so the same as we saw in the classification. Then we train both of them, and then we do the same thing. It's this prediction, except now the prediction, instead of giving you an integer, gives you a double, so it's a continuous value. So I gave it this random distribution, which you can see here. Like, this is the function we're trying to fit. It's this kind of random function that gives us these dots. And then it sees this and it goes, okay, as I move the x value, it's predicting y as a function of x. And you can see that they do both a, you know, fine job, more or less. Okay. So in that sense, like, classification and regression work similarly. Supervised learning, you add a whole bunch of samples, you train, and then you can predict at will. So something like that. And we're going to mostly be doing regression today. Any questions? If you're interested in doing, like, if you do use open frameworks and you're interested in doing, like, stuff with regular neural networks, this will be a pretty simple library, so it'll be probably your best option. When we get into convolutional neural networks, we have other stuff for that, so just be aware of that. And then one of the applications that I'll show you later today, maybe I should do that now. I'll show you later. I think I'll save it. Is based on OFX Learn, so it's there. It's available, but it's a little old school, so we're not going to use it too much. And then the last thing that OFX Learn can do, and we're not actually going to do this today, but just to be aware of, is clustering. And clustering means you don't have any labels. We just have a bunch of random dots. These are now 3D points, actually. We get a whole bunch of 500 3D points that are unassigned labels, and then we ask our cluster algorithm, which is, it uses a technique called k-means clustering. We ask it to cluster the dots into 5 clusters. So if we run this, oh, it's okay. So it's, I think it's calculating. Just close some of this other stuff. Uh, Okay. Did I? Is that running? Let's do that again. Yeah, it might also just be.
It took mine for a while to open.
Oh really? Oh, I think because. Actually, let's look at the console. Is this thing not working yet? I haven't checked this in a while.
Oh, yeah.
Yours is fine. Okay, I think mine. Oh, there we go. All right, good. So there's just a bunch of 3D points. We can kind of zoom out, and then it assigned them clusters. So imagine you have data that can be decomposed into three dimensions, and you want to assign them categories. This is a way you could do it. So that might be another tool. We'll look at clustering when we start to talk a little more about unsupervised learning. So this is a form of unsupervised learning, which means there's no labels except the ones that we give it. So that's just available, so just be aware of it. Okay, so...
Is that organizing it for you, or is it just segmenting it?
It's segmented, yeah. Or more concretely, it assigned each of the points a category, one of five, and it did so that close categories were next to each other. So it segments.
And how does it determine the amount of categories?
We told it. So we said give me five. There are other approaches that. Like if you don't know in advance how many there are, there's I forgot what it's called. There's one where it basically tries, a certain range of numbers for k, and then it figures out which one fits the best. The name escapes me. Adaptive k means something like that. Adaptive r means, I don't remember. Okay, so that's OFX Learn. So. And that's the basic workflow. And we'll kind of, when we start to use Reckoner, we'll see that we're going to be doing it in a similar way. Collect data, one point at a time, hit train, creates a model, and then we can use that model. All right. Let's go back to our agenda. So before we go into Reckoner, I really want to just quickly sort of tell you some other things that are available along the same lines, what we just looked at. I think still the easiest, Python-based machine learning framework is scikit-learn. How many of you are familiar with scikit-learn or have used it? Okay, scikit-learn is it's a Python-based machine learning library. It's really, really good. You can see it has the same categories that we do, and it has tons of examples that it comes with. It's just a really well done. This was the first really good Python machine learning library that's been around now for 10 to 15 years or something. We're going to end up using other ones that are more recent because some of the deep learning stuff is being done now in other environments. And actually, Scikit now has something called Scikit Flow, which is which is the scikit-learn of deep learning, and I haven't used it, so I'm not too familiar with it. But scikit-learn is a really good source to use. There's a few others that are sort of built on top of it, and I would also recommend for those of you who are interested in doing command line your own machine learning experiments, I would really recommend these tutorials by Francis Tseng, who some of you may know. He's here in New York. He basically has, if you go into this. And I'll share all these links in the notes. So if you don't get this link, we'll be sharing them later. But if you go into notebooks in this repository, he has a basic tutorial of how to do machine learning stuff with. And I think he's using Pandas, which is another machine learning library. Or maybe he's using Scikit. I can't recall. We'll pull it up. These are IPython notebooks, by the way, which are a format for. Packaging Python scripts where you can kind of run it as a terminal, almost as a terminal with a console, and it gives you an output. It's kind of a nice thing. We're not going to cover this today. We might use some of them later, so we might do a session on how to use them, but just be aware of the difference. It's just Python, though. He's using Pandas, which I haven't used Pandas. I can't recall whether or not it's related to Scikit. Okay, he's using pandas to for some part of it, but a lot of this is based on scikit-learn. So this is a linear regression example in scikit-learn, and he goes through the process of like doing exactly what we just did with his own example. So this is like classifying the height of a deer from the weight, or not predicting the height of a deer. So these are like really simple, like step-by-step tutorials that are a good way to kind of get acquainted with it. But because we're doing things at a sort of bird's eye level today, we're not actually gonna step through this. But for those of you who are interested in doing more like scientific computing, I definitely recommend looking at this later, because it's very well done. Classification and clustering also.
What's his name?
Francis Tseng. And there's also, so we're using Wekinator today. Wekinator is based on a Java-based library called Weka, which I don't really recommend using by itself, just because it's at this point somewhat of an old library, and it's weird Java-based. But there is actually, I'm familiar with a processing wrapper for Weka, which I tried using like a really long time ago, so I'm not even sure it still works anymore, but I just wanted, if anyone is like really, really into processing and wants to do what we were just doing in Python, but in processing, this might be a way to do it because it's a processing library. I'm just not positive that it still works. So that's something for just to be aware of. And then, when we get into deep learning, we'll be using some other libraries. And I'm still kind of deciding which ones we'll be using. Okay, so Wekinator. Let's talk about Wekinator.
Can you talk about more like platforms for machine learning rather than data?
Like a rough landscape. There's machine learning in virtually every platform, but the ones that are most popular tend to appear in Python. There's a number of Python machine learning libraries that I can kind of, I'll provide a list at some point, but like the ones that I just listed are sort of the ones that are most relevant right now. When we start to do deep learning, we'll start to see some other, like TensorFlow and Theano are Python based. There's also like a few wrappers on top of those that make it a lot easier, but I'll be talking about those in more detail later. So, does anyone here use MATLAB? You can also do machine learning stuff in MATLAB, which I highly, highly recommend against. Because I hate MATLAB. But it's very well developed for machine learning. It used to be kind of the dominant platform for that. There's also a lot of C code, but a lot of it is just old stuff. It's not really going to be the kind of stuff that we do here. I would really recommend kind of Python stuff just because the environment is so well developed. Wekinator. Let's look at the website. Wekinator is an application. It's Java based. So as I said, it's based on top of this machine learning framework called Weka, and it's being developed by Rebecca Fiebrink and some collaborators. Rebecca has been working on it since about 2008, 2009. What it does is it does all of what we looked at, so like the adding features, training, and predicting. It basically is an application which encapsulates all of that so that we don't have to code it ourselves, which is nice because the process of actually coding this is almost the same every time, right? It's kind of like a... instead of duplicating the effort, we can kind of use this tool, which basically is agnostic towards what you use it for, but just handles the machine learning. So we don't have to worry so much about like selecting a model, selecting parameters, and so on. That's stuff that we will get into when we get into things that there is currently no Wekinator for. But for the time being, Wekinator, I think, is a really, really good tool for this. And it's been targeted towards artists and musicians for a long time. So I think it's super, super good use for all the use cases that I think we'll be into. It's super good for that. The other thing is there's actually, Rebecca's teaching an online class right now on Cadenza. Is it pronounced Cadenza? Does anyone know? I've heard people say Cadenza. But this is actually going on right now. And we're doing a really abridged version today of Wekinator. So if you happen to get really into Wekinator, I'd really advise taking this course. You can just sign up at any time and all the materials will become available for you. That it will be a sort of much more thorough overview of Wekinator and how to use it. And we're gonna fly through it today. So, but we should kind of handle most of the major use cases. So I think it'll be okay for that. You can read through the webpage. It will just go over some of the different things you can do with it. And I'm gonna show you some of the, before we actually do a demo, I'm gonna show you some of the resources that exist. Let me just watch my time. We want to actually do a break today, right? So let's do a break around like 4, what would be like 4:30 or something? Okay, so let's really quickly look at the gallery so you can see some of the really cool things that people have done with Wekinator. So some of you might know Leticia Sonami, who's a really great sound artist who's using Wekinator for something. This is at our conference called Nine. That's New Instruments for Musical Expression.
We know about it.
Oh, you okay? All right, good. Yeah. this is a project that uses Wekinator. Actually, I'm sorry. Can I put the sound into the? Oh, yeah. Okay. So just because we're short on time, I'm going to go like halfway. First of all, that sounds rad, right? So I don't know exactly what's going on, but basically this is a very typical use case for Wekinator. This is some sort of a custom instrument that she built, which has a number of sensory inputs, and then Wekinator, and then she has a synthesizer somewhere, which in this case I'm not sure if it's an analog synthesizer or if it's a computer, but it has a bunch of parameters. Right, so like if you think about like let's say we have a frequency modulator, right? That we have like, or let's just work with a sine tone. Let's say we have a sine tone. A sine tone is characterized by a single number, the frequency, right? So all of these numbers can become targets for our machine learning. We can use something like Wekinator, or in this case we'll use Wekinator, to learn a relationship between our sensory inputs and the numbers that define our synthesizer. And then we can assign those numbers to our synthesizer and then control it with the sensory inputs. So that's kind of and we'll see this, we'll do some simple examples and build up to something like this. We're not going to make this instrument, but unfortunately, but you'll get the idea of what's going on. Actually, this is pretty cool. This is like using a webcam to watch a snake. I think it's using a web camera, and it makes sound. It's not Mozart, but it's pretty clever. So, what do Snakeinator and Leticia Sonami's instrument have in common? Like nothing, right? Basically, they have nothing in common. So like this is the cool thing about Wekinator. It creates like a way for one completely different thing to control one other completely different thing. So making complex mappings between inputs and outputs. And there's a bunch of other projects here that I would definitely recommend going through. There's also, like, the website has a whole bunch of instructions, and we're going to kind of go through some of these. I'm not going to use the ones on the website, but this will give you a much more thorough, there's like detailed instructions for this stuff. And we'll be kind of going through this in a pretty quick way. But I would definitely recommend looking at these later to help you sort of digest if there's any part of it that's unclear. Let's see here. Showcase. There's a lot of different stuff. And the showcase is there. Let's see here. Okay, so the instructions. Oh, there's also a Wekinator. There's a YouTube page. And there's not too many things here, but Rebecca has a few tutorials that, and we'll be demonstrating some of these actually, for setting up Wekinator to do a few different use cases. So those are available to you. And then there's the Cadence course, which again, definitely think about doing. And that's all, yeah. So let's go through, let's do a sort of a basic workflow for Wekinator. I'm going to show you how to use it, basically. So what we'll do from here is I'm going to show you like a basic example, and I'll show you like a few more complex examples and how to set them up and how to use them. And then after that, maybe we can riff on some different ideas, ways that you can think to set up your own experiments. The best way to think of Wekinator, and again, maybe I'll hammer this home a little bit after we see the more complicated examples, but it's almost like a switchboard. So, you know, if you have on one side a whole bunch of different kinds of inputs that you could use, and on the other side you have a whole bunch of different outputs, you can kind of like hot swap them. So let's say you have some awesome musical instrument you built in Ableton or something, and we'll do an Ableton example, and you want to control it with either the Kinect. You can control it with a Kinect, or you can put down that input and swap in a different input instead, like face tracker or something, and then control your Ableton program from there. So we'll see a few examples of this, and this is kind of the best way to think of Wekinator. It's this big switchboard. And so what's really interesting about it is that it's very combinatorially big, right? So if you have 10 different inputs that can be mapped to 10 different outputs, that's 100 different instruments you can build from that. So that's kind of a nice thing. Okay, so let's open Wekinator. Okay, this is what Wekinator looks like. So when you first open Wekinator, you're prompted with basically a screen that asks you to set it up. I didn't say anything about OSC. We talked about it last week, but let me step back and talk about the OSC part of it. So when I said that Wekinator is a switchboard because we can put different inputs on it and different outputs on it, we have to go over the way that they communicate. So like if I'm working with Ableton doesn't know what Wekinator is, right? The way we create the relationship is using something called Open Sound Control. I think last week most people raised their hands and were familiar with Open Sound Control. Can you raise your hand if you don't know what OSC is? Okay, a few people aren't familiar with it. We'll see it in use now, so I'll kind of just briefly say what it is. But OSC is a way for exchanging data between applications, which are either running on the same computer, which is all of the applications we'll be showing today, or on different computers over a network. So OSC is really good for network communication. It just makes it really easy for one application to control another. Because there's a sort of standard format, like a language, that they can communicate with each other. And they use network protocols to do it. So Wekinator lives in between your input application and your output application. So you'll have one input application, which is like sending its data to Wekinator. Wekinator takes that data and does machine learning stuff on it. And then it outputs data over OSC itself. So it takes in data over OSC, and then it outputs data over OSC. And then you can pipe that output to whatever application you want to use. So Ableton, for example. Ableton is actually a bad example because it doesn't take OSC by default. So there's a I've made a workaround for that, which I'll show you later. But basically anything that takes OSC. So let me show you an example of it. So the first thing you have to do is we by default. So with OSC, communicates over network network protocols, and the way network protocols work is that they have ports assigned to it. So you can only use one application can bind to one port at a time. So if you if Wekinator is listening over port 6448, which it does by default, and we'll just kind of use 6448. It's arbitrary, it's just made up. That means that we can send Wekinator data over OSC over port 6448. And then you have to turn it on. So we'll start listening. So now Wekinator is listening for data. And in that sense, we can send the data from anywhere. And we'll show you, and I'll show you a quick example of how to do that. Then with OSC, so OSC works like this. There's a port, there is an IP address, and there is and then for the messages we send, they all have addresses to have different kinds of messages. So we are by default listening for over localhost. So that's localhost is the IP address of your own computer, which is always 127.00.0.1. So it's only going to be listening for, we can send it from anywhere, but the point is that like this is just listening over this port. So if we send OSC messages to this computer at port 6448, Wekinator will pick it up. And what we have to do is what Wekinator is looking for is it's looking for a message with this address /wek/inputs, and with some number of inputs which we decide, and then that's how it grabs data. So let's do a simple example and just give it two inputs, which I'm going to send from the mouse basically, and we can look at some of the options. The options are just that you can give them names if you want. We're not gonna bother with that right now, but you can give them names, and you can also like make presets and save them and load them. We're not gonna look at that just because it's the kind of thing that you can see from the instruction sheet. But basically you can create full instruments, save them, and then just carry them around. So it's really, really convenient. It takes care of a lot of the grunt work and sort of programming this stuff. And then once it does the learning, it will be piping out a set of learned outputs over this address, and we'll just leave it at the default WEC outputs. And let's just have one for now. And this is where it sends it to. So so we're going to be sending data from Wekinator, which will control another application. If you want to control an application on your own computer, on the same computer, you just do it over localhost. You can also send it to different IP addresses. So if I set an IP address of one of your computers, then I'll be sending that data to you. So that's kind of a nice, neat thing, and maybe we'll try to do that at some point. I'm not even sure I'm on the same network as you guys, because NYU guest, I don't know if they'll actually be connected. That'll be a good experiment, we can see. And then by default, it's sending 12,000, yeah?
Could you possibly send to multiple computers?
Not through Wekinator, because because I have, this just has one OSC sender. Yeah, so that's the kind of thing that, like, if you, there might be, maybe there's some sort of broadcasting option. I'm not aware of any. You could, for example, make a broadcasting application. So, like, send this to some other application on your computer that's broadcasting. So that's something. So, yeah, there's always a workaround. But Wekinator, by default, just sends the one. Just for the sake of keeping everything clean and easy. So when we do that, when we click next, we get this interface. So I'm just gonna take a tour of the interface. So let's look at this screen first. So we specified that we have one output. So in this box is where your outputs appear. So we just have one. If we had more than one, you'd see a few of these, right? And then this is the value of the output. as just continuous between 0 and 1, right? And right now, we just have control of it, right? But it's a value, it's a real numbered variable, which we can go to. And then these buttons I'm going to show you in just a second, but basically this is where they appear. The left panel here is our menu. Now recall, like in the Open Frameworks examples, the first thing we did was we added a whole bunch of examples, like we gave it data, right? So that's what this button does, start recording. When you click start recording, what it's doing is it's now listening for messages of data, for data, which we're going to send it. Now we're not sending it anything, so it's not collecting anything, but it's listening, right? So this is kind of where you start the listening process, and I'm gonna show you how to send data to it. And we'll show I'll show these other buttons later, but basically you remember that after collecting data, you hit train. We did the same thing in our examples, we hit train. And then run just starts to predict continuously. And then I'll show the other buttons they'll be self-explanatory when we actually take in some data. Let's actually make a program send data. I'm actually, now there's a few, if you downloaded the Wekinator examples, there's a bunch that it comes with, so we can look at some of those, but what I want to do is actually go through the process of making one in processing, because I imagine maybe some people might want to do that. It's a really good exercise, and it's really simple to do. So let's do that. I'm going to open processing. I'm using processing 2, just because I haven't updated to 3 yet. How many people here use processing or have used it? So most people are pretty familiar with processing. I know it's pretty standard here. How many people here use P5.js? Okay, so like about the same number, I guess. You can do this with P5.js also. So there are ways to hook up OSC, which I've actually been working on. So if you're interested in doing this stuff with P5, let me know, and I can direct you to it. It's a little bit weirder with P5 just now because it's in the browser, so network communication is kind of wonky. But so that's why I'm using processing. But it's easy enough to do. I'm gonna piggyback on one of the OSC examples. And actually, I forgot to mention this, but if you want to do processing stuff, you have to have this library called OSCP5. If you use processing a lot, I'm sure you know it. It's this library by Andreas Schlegel. It basically just sets up OSC for processing. So this library is required. OSC. So I forget which one of these I want to use, but it's send receive. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm just going to adapt this example. I'm going to take from it what we need. So we need to import OSCP5. And first of all, is that all big enough for everyone? Can you guys see? Is anyone not see? Okay. So we'll kind of hook this up. And then in setup, we'll more or less copy this. I'm going to make a canvas that's like 500 by 500. And then we're going to create a new P5 object. And then this is actually listening. So when you create this and give it a port, this means that it's listening for objects in port 12,000. We are not going to use this to listen to messages, so it doesn't matter what you make this. But I'm actually going to change this to like 1, 2, 3, 4, because 12,000 also happens to be the port we're sending from, so I just don't want to have a conflict. But we're not even going to use this port, so it doesn't matter what it is. This is the important one. My remote location is where are we going to send data to? So this is where we're sending data from processing to. Since we're sending it to my computer, from my computer, we're just using localhost, so you can either make it 127.0.0.1, or you can also just write localhost, they're the same thing. I'll just leave it like this, though. And we want to send it to Wekinator, so 6448, right? Sending to Wekinator on the same computer. IP address is localhost, or 127.0.0.1. Wekinator's default port is 6448. You can change it if you want, but we'll just use 6448.
Increase the size.
The size of the font? Oh, sure. Maybe 18? Is that okay? Good? Okay. So that's the main thing, and then this is what we can do. We can send, I'm going to do a really quick demonstration of sending a single message. So here's what we'll do. We'll make a keypressed method, and when I hit the spacebar, we're going to send the message from processing to Wekinator. So I have the spacebar, and this is how you do it. You create an OSC message. I'm going to share this code, by the way, so just so you know. I need to make a note of it, though. so don't forget. Share Wekinator code. Okay, OSC message. And we basically go, okay, we need to give it an address. So when you instantiate it, you give it an address. And remember what the address was? We specified in Wekinator. And actually, here I'll just go back so we can see it. So Wekinator. So this is where we decide right here, 6448. And then this is the address that it's looking for. So the slashes are sort of conventions. You'll see in OSC there's often slashes. You don't have to use slashes at all, but it's just a convention that you'll see a lot. So we'll just use the same one. And we're going to send it 2 again, so I'll switch this to 2. And then this is the address where inputs. Right. So start listening. We'll do 1 output. And all continuous. Yeah. Okay. So I'll let that be here. And then message, so wek/inputs. And then we want to add 2 values to it. So let's add 0.5 and then 2.5. I just made these up, just so to see. Then you go oscp5.send message to my remote location. And we can get rid of this now. Okay, so now if we send this, this should work, I hope. So this goes here. I'm going to go here and now start recording. So now Wekinator is listening. It says recording, waiting for inputs to arrive. I'll go back to processing, and I'll hit the spacebar, and we got a new example recorded, right? So this is basically how you send data to Wekinator. You send it from an application like processing, and we can look at the examples. So here, now if you go to examples, and click on the magnifying glass, you'll see that we have recorded one example. Gives us a timestamp. And then these are the values, input 1, input 2, and then the output value, which we just have at 0. We had at 0, right? So if we send this again, so like I'll leave this at 0.73 now, I'll hit the spacebar again, we get another example, same inputs because that's what we put in, and then the output now is 0.73. And recording round is like when we hit, because we're every time we can create rounds. This helps us keep track of like which samples came from which recording rounds, and then we can kind of you'll see why it's useful. We can get rid of entire rounds of samples if we want. So let's see here. That's basically how we input data. So the whole idea is that we'll collect a whole bunch of examples which have some input data and have a corresponding output. And then we'll ask Wekinator to learn the relationship between the inputs and outputs, and then so that it can predict the new ones. So let's set it up to do that. Okay. So what I'll do is instead of this, let's just think what the best. So let's do this. Actually, I'm going to save this. Let me make a new folder here. Some other examples, so I can make a few. Send 1 sample.
So is the output always a normalized value, 0 to 1?
It doesn't. You can change that. I think you can change it. I think it, I forgot if you can change that. So I often just work with 0 to 1 and then whatever application is receiving it to just rescale it. But I think you can actually change it. Continuous load from file. Maybe you can't actually. Maybe it is just always 0 to 1.
But for inputs, is it arbitrary as long as it's a numerical value and it's consistent?
For
the inputs could be.
Oh yeah, yes. Because Weaconator will normalize it for you.
Okay.
Yeah. Will it actually? Actually, I'm not even sure if it does. You can send it arbitrary data. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
What kind of data
we
can send?
Numerical data. So like this, for example, I just gave it to, just numerical data. And we'll show some examples, so a little bit more concrete. Okay, so now I'm gonna, send training data mass to B. Okay, so here's what we'll do. When I press the spacebar, we'll set Weaconator. So we're going to create just a boolean is sending, which is false. And then when I click the spacebar, this will become true, or it'll become. This is a trick in Java to basically just toggle. So the spacebar will let us toggle whether or not it's on. And what we'll do is we'll send the message if is sending, we'll send the mouse. So here, we're going to say mouse X and mouse Y is our message. So just to review this again, we set up our OSC, and then in draw, as long as this is on, which we can turn on by pressing the spacebar, it will on every frame send to Weaconator the mouse position. So let's actually see that. If I start recording, so this is now recording, and I'll run this. Now what I'll do is I'm going to hit the spacebar, and it will start to send OSC to Weaconator, and it will give us the value of the mouse X and mouse Y. So I'll hit the spacebar. Stop. You see that it recorded 140 new examples. So those are every frame. And we can see them. And the, oh, that's weird. 0 and 0? That doesn't look right. Maybe they have to be floats? Floats.
Yeah.
It might be that they have to be floats. Look at those again. Yeah, okay. Okay, so that's a little thing. It didn't accept integers. So just make sure you're sending float. I didn't know that, actually. Should probably try to accept integers. Anyway, yeah, it's accepting all of this. So here's our mouse values and the assigned, the assignment, right? If we stop recording and then start recording again, and then run this again, you'll see that it adds them now. It's a second recording round. That's kind of nice because we can, if you mess up, you can just delete the last round. So if we go delete last recording, it just removes, it removed basically the, we can look at this again. Not sure I. Oh, it actually deleted round one. Okay, sorry. So now we have 0. Okay, so basically it just deletes the last one that you added. So now we have 0. We're back to 0. So let's do a basic classifier. What I want to do is I want to assign points in the sort of top left quadrant here to be 0. And then here it'll be 1. And this is going to be a really simple example, but basically let's just do that. So I'm going to add a whole bunch of examples, stop, that were around here. Now I'm going to, so we stopped, right? Stop recording. Now I'm going to change the output to be 1. And I'll start recording again. And now I'll hit the spacebar and I'll be down here in the bottom right. Stop. Okay, so if we look at the data again, we see that I took inputs that are sort of low, top left corner, and I mapped them to output 0. And then the second round, I took high mouse values and I mapped them to 1. Okay? So now what we can do is we can stop recording, we can hit train, and now it's trained our output. So we can hit run. Do you have a question?
Yeah. Why do I have some of my outputs as X's?
I'm not sure. Are you sending from processing?
Yeah.
Does it look like this?
After that, I get the 0 and then the 1. But then
Maybe it didn't receive properly. I'll have to look at it. Yeah, maybe after class. Okay. So now that it's trained, I can hit run. Now, if we send the data again, so again, I'll turn this on so that it's recording. And you see my mouse is over here. I move the mouse down here, and you see it automatically goes to where it should be. So it's doing, it learned the relationship between the mouse and the parameter value that we desire. Right? Let's do actually a somewhat more complicated example. And actually also, just to make this clearer, we'll say that if sending, we'll clear the screen. OS, sorry. If you use open frameworks and processing a lot, you'll start to do what I just did. So this, we'll make the screen red when we're not recording, and then when we are recording, it'll make it green, so it'll be clear when we're sending data. I'm going to start this over again, and I'm going to make 2 outputs now. 2 inputs, 2 outputs, start listening, and go. Okay? So if we start recording, and we're going to let these be 0, 0 when mouse is over here, basically. Okay, good. Now when I put the mouse in the left corner, I want this to be like here, and this to be here. So let's record some more. Now, maybe like this, and I'm just making up values now, basically. It's going to be here, and then we'll say this. Okay, so let's train that. Let's train. Now we can run. So you can see what it's doing. It's doing really poorly on the first parameter, probably because I boxed it in somehow. yeah, I probably, like, it's strange. It should be. Oh, there we go. Okay. I think maybe it was a little weird bug. Slider wasn't updating. Okay, so you can see what it's done. It's basically, it's, if these values don't make sense to you, it's the case that what's important to understand about them is that it's basically doing what we trained it to do. So remember when we were up in the top right corner here, both of the values, we had set them to be mostly 0. When we were over here in the top left corner, we set them to be roughly like this. And all the other points, it just kind of fills in and extrapolates what it thinks are the best. Okay? So the idea is it's learning a relationship between the inputs that we define and the outputs that we also define. And then it kind of, it does it. And then it can learn them. So it's 4:30. So let's do this. Let's take a quick break, like a 5-minute break or something like that. And then when we come back, since I'm behind schedule a little bit, we're gonna start to make the examples a little more complicated, a little more interesting, a little more fun. So, okay, let's break. So that was 15 minutes. Should I have to? I'll start cracking the whip. We're all at leisure here.
I should just start.
Yeah, good idea. All right. You see, I'm a big softie. I don't even know how to discipline my own class. So don't.
I'm ready. Let's do this.
So don't abuse. Okay. So we're gonna do. Let's do a more complicated example. And for that, I'm going to use Face Tracker, which is everyone loves Face Tracker. Everyone's seen it. And it actually makes it for a really good example. So here's what we'll do. I'm going to launch Wackinator. Actually, before we set up Face Tracker, let's actually make Wackinator do something. So besides for just predicting these values, let's see what the point is. So I'm going to make a simple example. Okay, so let's do this. I'm going to start listening. And let's have three outputs. And here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to set up a processing sketch that actually takes these. So let's open processing, another version of processing. And I'm just going to copy all this and just change what we need. So basically now this new application is going to be accepting OSC. So we don't need this My Remote Location. All of this will be doing is just grabbing data from Wackinator. And I think I should remember how to do this using the send receive. Yeah. So the way OSCP5 works with messages is like this. So it grabs this message. I'm just gonna, there's like a listener. And then we can go if the address. Know why it's just say address, but I don't know. Is WEC/WEC/ outputs, then we're gonna get data, and that data will appear as floats, and so it'll be like float f1 equals this dot get zero float value. It has a really weird syntax actually, OSCP5, but so it goes. So if we're accepting three, they would look like this. We can get rid of this other stuff. I hope this works. I think it works. So I'll just print them to the console. Okay, so if I set this up, and what we do is, okay, OSCP5. Now this is where this address becomes important, this to answer your question earlier. This address right here, this number right here is the incoming port. So this means processing is listening on this port. Well, we set Wackinator to send over port 12,000. So if we set this to 12,000, this will begin listening for messages from Wackinator. So now if we run this, it's listening. Okay, so if we change one of these, nothing happens. Great. maybe because it has to be running. What did I do wrong? Oh, probably because I don't have the. Let's just print the address. I must have gotten the wrong. Let's do that again. Oh, /WEC/outputs. Yeah. Isn't this the way you do /WEC/outputs, right? Did I do the comparison right? Oh, I remember. It's because it's like in Java, it's like you have to do dot equals for strings. I think it's this. Okay, great. Okay, now it's working. Good. So I'll get rid of those. So now when we're running this, you'll see that when we change these values, they appear in the console of processing. So we're receiving these values. They're between 0 and 1 by default. So let's interpret them as red, green, and blue values and just change, do a really simple thing and just change, like do the background 255 times F1, 255 times F2, 255 times F3, right? Because this is grabbing these three values between 0 and 1, and then it will just, yeah. So we can see what's going on. Now we're controlling the background of our sketch. Okay, so this is like a really simple thing that you can do with Wekinator. We can pipe it to processing and have it control something. So how are we going to control it? How about we use FaceOSC? And I'm going to show you what FaceOSC is. How many of you have used FaceOSC? A few people. So FaceOSC is an open frameworks application that's based on FaceTracker, which is exactly what it sounds like. It's a face tracking library, and Kyle made it. And it's based on some work by this researcher named Jason Sarai, made FaceTracker. And I guess Kyle's maintaining it now. But basically, FaceOSC sends the coordinates of the face over OSC. So we're going to use that as our input. So I'm going to start listening, and I'm going to open up FaceOSC, which I have a few. I think I asked you guys to download it, so you should have it. But if you don't, you can just follow along. All of these will work. So I'm just going to open this. Okay, so it found my face. Hello. Get rid of my hair. Okay. Now, I'm going to turn off these things, and I'm just going to send the raw data. And I happen to, I should actually have it write this down in the console, but I happen to know that it sends 132 numbers. So there's it takes the entire mesh of the face, and there are 66 points that it's tracking, and it takes the X and the Y of each of those points. So that's 66 times 2, there's 132 points, which correspond to the location of my face. So that'll be our inputs. This is actually just set up to send, like I built it to send to the default address of Wekinator, so like it's already sending to /wek/inputs. So FaceOSC should work out of the box, basically, with Wekinator. So if we start listening for 132 inputs, and we'll have, again, three outputs, start listening, send. Okay. Is it Siri? Siri, okay. So we're sending that data, and yeah, it should be good, ready to go. So here's what we'll do. Let's map, like, some facial gestures, or sorry, it's like facial positions to different colors, okay? So how about this? We'll make red. So I set these outputs to be red. Okay, so here's red. Oh, I got a good idea. We'll do frown to smile. Okay, so like red is going to be frowning, and green will be smiling. Or no, blue should be frowning, right? So we'll go. Okay, sorry. Happy is red, sad is blue. Okay, so this is happy. So I will smile and keep my eyes open and record a bunch of examples. So this is sending, and I'm going to hit record, and I'll kind of try to smile. So hello, record. Oh, something's not right. Zero examples recorded. Something's not happening right. Why not? Am I sending?
Yeah.
It should be. You know what? Let me use this. This should definitely work. You might have to use this one. That might be the thing. Okay. Let's try this. So, okay. So. Okay, good. Now we'll change it to blue, and I'll try to be sad, very forlorn. Okay. I don't know. so we'll. I don't have a sad face, I guess. All right. Okay, so this is training. This will take a lot longer to train because there's 132 columns in the data now, so it's a little bit more complex. But it shouldn't take too long, maybe a minute or so. And then when we, so once it's done training, I can hit run, and then it will begin to take whatever I send it and try to classify it. And it should be done very soon. 2 of 3 done, so one more to go. And yeah, this is the waiting part of machine learning. You have to you have to wait a lot. Okay. Oh, it's done. Okay. So let's hit run. And now, so I think it's my hair is confusing it. Okay, it's pretty fun. Very responsive instrument. But first of all, so I just to bring it back, like, does everyone kind of understand what's going on, like, in the context of what we've seen so far? Maybe just to back up and, like, review what happened. We fed it a whole bunch of examples, right? So these are our inputs, and these are just a bunch of coordinates of my face. That's just the X, Y position of all the points of my face. And when I was smiling, we associated it with these three output values, 100. So most of these first few are just like me smiling, 100. Then we started feeding it me not sad, but normal, I guess. I didn't have a sufficiently convincing sad face. And we fed it, we made it 001. And so these examples, they all look the same, but they're actually different, right? So those were fed to it. And then we hit train, and it learned a mathematical relationship between our inputs and outputs so that it can grab an unknown that could take my face and then predict which of the things I'm doing. And it's not classifying, it's actually just regression. Yeah?
Will it work with other people?
Yeah. Like, you want to try? depending on how I'm normalizing it, let's see if it'll work with, like, if we just swap faces. Okay, so let me get out of the frame, and you can try doing what I was doing. So I'm gonna hit run. It doesn't find you. You're invisible. There you go. So let's try. Look into the camera. It doesn't. Are you? You're. Ghost in the machine. Yeah, I think you have to face forward. So yeah, maybe this one is a little too specific to my face because of the mesh, but you know, we can think of ways. This will, when we start to look at more data stuff, we can think of ways to. Yeah, yep.
This time you made an extreme case of happy face and you make that value to maximum. But if you do, make it more detailed.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, totally. So let's do this again, except with a little more nuance. Yeah, so let's stop this, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to get rid of all these examples. I hit X. So let's do this. Instead of just smiling, and I'm going to, like, maybe leaning is a good one. So if I do, it won't pick up my face if I lean too much. Okay, how did this? Leaning angled and open mouth is red. Oh. These have to match, so. Okay, now let's do, like, green will be leaning this way and looking up, maybe? Or how about just leaning this way? And then we can do blue is going to be open mouth straight. And then maybe we can do one more that's like cyan or something. Is this cyan? That can be like, what's that?
Down.
You might lose me, but yeah, I can.
What about eyebrows?
Ah, good one. That's a good one, yeah. Okay, let's train that. So now it's going to train these three. And yeah, it'll take a while. While it's training, maybe this is a good opportunity to field questions. Any questions? Can't screencast too much of myself. Okay, well, it's okay, so it's got one of three done. And let's just think about what the next thing we can do. Okay, so the next thing I'll do is actually we can also show some examples in the Wecanator package, and we can do a classification example too. So this has all been regression, but we can show some classification and maybe start to build some more interesting applications. And Wecanator actually comes with a bunch. So let's see, it's five, so I have about 45 minutes.
Does this allow you to combine like classification and regression, or?
Yeah, you can in the when you do the when you config in the initial configuration screen, you can it gives you an option to do a custom set of outputs. So some can be classification, some can be classifiers, some can be continuous. So the option is there to mix and match. There's also one other thing called dynamic time warping, which I'm hoping we have time to do, maybe at a basic level. Okay, so this is done. So let's try it. Okay, I don't even remember anymore what we trained. Let's run. Okay, so eyebrow up was cyan, right?
Yeah.
It's pretty good. Yeah, we should have written down. Yeah. So that's kind of, yeah, you want to know. Actually, I have a funny story about that, but I'm not going to. Yeah, you should write down the classes as you go. Otherwise, you'll forget, like, after a few hours of collecting examples, it can be kind of funny. Okay, so, like, that's basically regression. We can do a little a sort of survey of different inputs that you could use. So all of the outputs that we're doing are super simple right now. It's just the background color. But let's do a quick survey of inputs, and then we'll talk about doing more sophisticated things on the other side of it. So FaceOSC is one that we have. Connect is another one. Maybe I can do that real quick with the same. Let's do that. Actually, you know what? I'm gonna hold off on that until we get to connect to gesture, because then it'll kind of go together. But connect is another input that works pretty well, right? If you have skeleton joints, you can use those as features. Let's see what other ones I've sort of prepared. Ableton's an output. Ableton's a good output, and we can do that. Yeah, I'll show that. So there's a few that come with process with Wecanator, which are really nice, and I'm going to show you a few of them. So inputs. So first of all, some of these are just to kind of do a little survey, because I haven't used even most of these. So like, for example, I'm sure a lot of you guys are good with Arduino, do a lot of Arduino stuff. This is an example that comes with the Wecanator examples folder, which shows you how to hook up Arduino via MaxMSP to Wecanator. And I think, I believe, I haven't looked at it, but I'm sure that it would go like, for those of you who have used Arduino inside of MaxMSP or in processing, both of those have serial readers, so Arduino communicates over the serial port. And then once you have it in Max and processing, you can do what we just did. You can send it over OSC to Wecanator. So this is a good way to get, like, if you're doing like physical computing or sensory stuff, you can use that as features, and that's really cool. And I know a lot of people are doing, like, this is something I do almost zero Arduino, so like I won't have a ton of ideas, but like, I don't know, I've seen like people doing like tracking the weather and tracking like moisture in the plant and all these things, these can become features which can then you can use to control things. So definitely start to think about it. I'd love to see someone do some Arduino stuff. That would be really rad. And this is the Arduino code. So it kind of comes with it. They also, Rebecca developed this at while she was at Princeton, and all the sound lab there uses, they're really into using these game track tether things. Have you seen these? Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It's like a game controller that has these tethers, and then they like play like, I don't know, it's really bizarre. I don't know, they use it there for some reason a lot.
Like a theremin slash...
Yeah, you can use it like a theremin, I think. You know, it's like, it's just a big rope that kind of... Anyway, if anyone uses those, you can use that. This is just straight Java. I'm sure no one will really use this. I think probably processing is easier. Leap motion, and I actually have my own leap here, and we can use that as well. The leap thing works pretty well. I think you could just use this. In fact, let's just try it. Why not do an example with leap right now? So I'm going to use one of the Wekinator examples, and I haven't even used it yet. So like this will show you like how easy it is to kind of just start with one of these. Is your question?
Yeah. When it's training, is it training upon the sort of like the coordinates of the points in the space or the relationship between the points?
Well, it's learning the relationship between the input points that you gave it and the output points that you associated with it. In like the way that we saw with the neural networks last week, trained over. Like digits, right? It figured out a mathematical relationship between your inputs, which is the pixels, and your outputs, which were the 10 classes. Okay, so let's try this leap motion example. And actually, oh, you know what? I probably don't even... Yeah, you have to get a library. Okay, so let me use my own. So if you just get this library, and you have to find it, you could use the leap motion example. How many of you guys have worked with leap motion before? A little bit? Okay, so it's one of these finger hand tracking sensors, and I just released this today. This is basically sending this over OSC to, it does this, it does tracking on the hand, and mine is super fidgety. This is like really old. This is like from the first alpha batch or something of the developer kit that they sent out. So mine is like, it has super weird connectors and stuff, but it actually still works, not bad. So you see it's a hand tracker, and it's really good. It could do two hands. And I'm sending the right-hand coordinates. So the only thing is that there's a weird bug in the software that doesn't send it while... Let's actually go through this process. I'm gonna stop this. Going to make a new one. Let's get rid of this. I just happen to know that this is sending 31 values. So we'll have 31 inputs, 3 outputs as before. Send. And now I can start recording. So let's just say, let's associate open hand high, like this, with red. Okay, so we'll have this. And then this is a weird thing. It only actually sends value when I'm active. This is a bug in my thing. I have to fix it. So it won't actually send values when I'm... See, it stops updating. So I'm just going to get this and then hit recording and then go back. Okay, so start recording. So I'm kind of waving my hand around just to get some basic different, you know, just a little bit different... behaviors. Let's go to green. You don't have to use extreme values, right? You can give it whatever you want. So you're determining the relationship you want to see. And let's make like low fist, sort of, or like low closed. So that'll be green. So start recording. Kind of down here, keeping these fingers close. And stop. And then maybe we'll do like blue, and maybe we can associate it with like vertical hand, or maybe like you can think of different different.
They're rocking
hedge.
It.
Rocking. It might not track. Oh, look at that. Wow, it's not so bad. Okay, yeah, good idea. I like it. Yeah, let's do blue is the rocking hand. So start recording. Move it around. I like that. Okay, good. So we'll hit train. It's 1,000 examples on 31 values. So it's training. And then it should be able to, yeah, do what we wanted. Okay, so 1 of 3 is done. While it's doing that, let's just look at the others. So that's Leap Motion. And if you want to use Leap Motion, you can use this. I just posted it today. So if you go on my GitHub, you'll find Leap OSC. With that little weird bug, you have to be active in it for it to work, which is, it has to be focused. The focus has to be on the application for it to work. Otherwise, I would recommend maybe trying this. You just have to install this processing library if you want to use the Leap. I guess most people want to use it, but it's available in case you're interested in doing hand stuff. Okay, so let's go back to Wekinator. Great. So now, okay, rock hand, high, low, rock hand, high. And you see what it's doing, like it gradually, it learns, it's able to interpolate between them, right? So it's not just that it's associating, like I'm giving it the things that we trained it on. You know, we did a high hand open, right? But what about things that it doesn't know? Like what about high hand closed? Well, that's interesting, right? It's like, so low hand closed we know is green. We did that. That was the second batch of examples. High hand open is red. What's high hand low? Or sorry, high hand closed. It's that, right? And some color in between. Or maybe open low. Okay, so that's just green, basically. This is rock hand, right? What about left rock hand? What if I, sorry. Okay, now it's not capturing. So yeah, you can see what it's doing, right? Where it's interpolating this space of possible inputs and finding a sort of smooth representation which is able to learn the features that you gave it. So yeah, that's Leap Motion, so that's kind of nice. Let's see some, oops.
Is there a way to tell it to kind of like, to mesh in between the outputs versus deciding like 1 or 0? So you know, so you have like open and closed hand, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so it can output either like 0 or 1 or quick. Can you tell it to always just kind of smooth in between the two?
If you mean like smooth interpolations?
Yeah.
So in Wekinator, I don't think there's really a smoothing function. So I think this is like, maybe there is in the config. I don't know if there's one way to do it through Wekinator. One way we could do it on our side, though, is to smooth what we're receiving. And that would actually be really easy. In fact, I can show you right now. So instead of just doing this, let's say we had float RGB. And then instead of just doing this, we could say R is equal to lerp R. This is a way to do easing. And let's say at this fast. So for those of you guys who aren't super familiar with processing, don't worry too much. This is just like a thing you can do to make the outputs change a little smoother, is to do easing. So this will take whatever red had before, the new value, and it will just go 10% of the way towards it. So that over a few frames, it should go slower. So if we do this now, and run Leap OSC. You see now it's a little smoother. It's still jumpy on the Wekinator side, but on the processing side, it's much smoother. We could probably even make it even. So now this will be really apparent. Now it's really slow, right? Nice reveals. Okay, so those are all things that are available to you. Okay, so I don't want to do it that slow though. So let's just. But that's a good question. So that's one way you could do it on your side. In the Wekinator side, I don't think there's really a way to do it to smooth the outputs. I think that would complicate the interface actually. So probably better that it's not doing that. Okay, so let's look at some more of the inputs. So MaxMSP can be an input. How many people here use MaxMSP? Okay, a lot of people. So let's actually show. There's a bunch of Max objects. And there's an open sound control object. If you read in the README, it'll tell you where you can get this. But basically, there's a special object that you have to use that makes the, that basically shows you, that sends OSC to Wekinator. So here's an example. I just have a demo version of Max. But basically, like, this is a bark analyzer. This might be a good one to try, actually. But let's wait until we do. Let's try this. Okay, let's see. This is sending 25 bark code. Okay, so this is doing an audio analysis. So it's going to the microphone and it's giving me the bark coefficients. So for those of you guys who do some like audio analysis, bark coefficients are like these perceptual frequency bands. Like strengthen these perceptual frequency bands. That is a good characterization of audio. So you can see that it should have a different pattern. Like if I go into the microphone and go, it kind of looks like that. And if I go, it might look a little different. Or maybe, okay, so that's kind of nice. So like we can try to do audio mapping. So let's do that. I'm going to start up Wekinator. Getting tired of this background example, but let's just for the sake of time kind of keep with it. So this has 25 inputs, so we want 25 inputs. You got to make sure these always match, right? And then 3 outputs. Okay, and we'll say red is going to be, let's just do other colors now, actually. how about yellow? Yeah. Okay, and let's actually run this. Let me save this real quick before I... PO3, see background. Okay, so if I run this, okay, and oh, there's a conflict. Gotta get rid of this. And back to Wekinator. Now it should be, yeah, it's like 25, it should be sending now. So let's do this. Okay, now let's do cyan. Or actually, how about we'll just invert these. What did I do? I did right, okay. Now let's do whistle. We'll whistle. Okay, now let's train those. Okay, 2 of 3 done. Good. Okay, so now run this. All right. You get the idea, right? So now we're characterizing our voice. So that's pretty neat. And actually, this will be really handy when we. This is kind of cool. This is basically, by the way, what we're doing is the it's going crazy, huh? What we're doing is basically the beginning of like speech to text. This is how speech to text works. It's machine learning. You analyze the audio, you take all the features from it, and then you pipe it into some learning algorithm. Now, in our case, we're doing a regression, but you could imagine like, what if we did a classification? Where we have 10 different phonemes or 10 different words, and we train a whole bunch of words, we'll say the word, analyze it, and associate it with one particular output. That's how you do classification in speech to text. So you can see how we're brushing up to like real life sort of scientific, industrial, commercial problems. Okay, so that's pretty cool. So that's available in Max. And just in principle, like anything that you do in Max is available. So if you have any Max program that generates numbers and you want to associate, you want it to control some other thing, you can, you know, this is just an example using sliders, but that's available to you. So Max is really, really great. Lots of people using Max with Wekinator. So if you guys are into Max, definitely start to hack Max and Wekinator. Okay, so let's just look at some of the others. Okay, so there's a few open framework examples. This one is the one that I actually put in. So this is the one that'll do face tracking. You should use this one. We looked at it just now. And this is a simple mouse in open framework. So this is basically what we did in processing. So we're not going to open it right now, but there's a few open framework examples. Anybody here use PD, Pure Data? Okay, a couple people. Pure Data. Pure Data is like MaxMSP, right? It was made by the same person, actually, except it's a free version of it, so it's really cool that way. But it's a little harder to use. I haven't used it in a long time, so I don't have any examples for it. Some processing examples. Oh, the webcam. Let's use the webcam. Yeah, this is good. And maybe just for the sake of time, I'm going to do a classification with it. How about this? Let's get out of this, and let's switch to doing classification. How about this? We'll switch this example. The receive background. I'm gonna make a copy. Receive class. So now we're going to do a classification problem. So let's say we have this value C, and C is 0. And we'll say, if C is 0, background black. And if C is 1, background green. And when we receive a message, it comes out as a float. We're just gonna get one, and then we'll turn it into an integer, and we'll say C is equal to this. So basically, when we get a Wekinator always sends floats. It's kind of a weird thing, but we're gonna interpret it as an integer, and then this should work, I guess. So let's save this, and I'm gonna set this up to have one output. And this is how you set it up to do classification. Instead of this, you go all classifiers. Instead of all continuous, you do all classifiers. So, and this will have, each one will have, let's say, two classes. Okay, so, and we're gonna use this webcam. So this webcam is sending 100 input values. And it just basically downsamples the webcam to 100 pixels, and it sends the actual values. So we're going to set this up to be 100 inputs, and go next. And then we can record some examples. So now this is how classification works. We're going to record a bunch of examples for class 1. So let's say class 1 is just me inside the frame. Okay.
How does it send 100 values with 100 pixels? Is it only alpha?
It looks. I actually don't know. We can check right now. It's just a sum. Is it sum? Wait. Let's see. If we look here, we can check. But I think
like brightness?
It might be brightness or it might be an average. Yeah, I can't even tell. Color fill. If you look at this, I'm guessing it's diff. I think it's summing them. It's summing their difference from it looks like
the frame.
The previous and the
Yeah, you would have to look at it, but basically it turns the three into some value, and I think it's just the sum of their difference, their sum, not quite the raw sum. It looks like maybe it's from an average of some kind, but basically it's a single number for each pixel. Yeah, good question. So we'll associate this, and we should get rid of some, yeah. So these are running. Let's make sure max isn't running. And so let's try this. So basically, here I am, and we'll send these. So these, we're going to associate these with class 1. Okay, so it gets a whole bunch of examples. So let's do that. And then with class 2, I'm going to just take myself out of the frame. So now we'll record class 2. This is basically one of the examples that Wekinator, that are on YouTube. So I'm just, you can see this again on the YouTube channel. So I'll train this. And I actually might have the OSC addresses wrong. So let's see what happens. I think I might just... let's look at the address. Training is completed. So now we can hit run. And it's receiving... okay, so yeah, it should be... so that's inside. Now... oh, that's not working. So let me just see what... how does it send? WEC outputs. And then... so if I get out of the frame... is it not doing so?
What comes out of the Wekinator? Is it 1 and 2?
So this is 2.
But so it's sending out 2?
Yeah.
You're
I think so.
0, 1.
I forget the exact format. Let's just look, actually, because I might be... Right. It might be 1 and 2. You might be right. So let's just see, actually, what the value is if we print it to the console. Oh, okay, yeah. Mm-hmm. So I just had it. It should be if 1 and then if 2. Okay. So it was just 1 and 2 rather than 0 and 1. So now it should work. Okay, so I'm in the frame. And I'm out the frame. In the frame. Out the frame. So this is a way to create actions, right, that occur. So you classify an event and then have an action. Then you can associate with something. Okay, so that's pretty cool.
It's very much very similar to the number classification.
Yes, absolutely. It's classification. Yeah, it's just a classification problem. Mm-hmm. Very much similar. Let's see. So we did these. Let me just think. Okay, processing mouse, webcam. We looked at bark bands, face OSC, connect. We didn't do yet. Just a few others that I want to mention that we're not going to do, but are worth knowing about. The Wiimote is, you guys know the Wii, right? So like that wand gives you accelerometer data and so on. So you can use that as an input. There's an example that it comes with. If you know how to send OSC, if you guys know Touch OSC, right? So you can use an application called Touch OSC, which lets you send OSC messages from your phone. And it has access to the phone's accelerometer, things like that. So like if you can imagine sending that data from a phone, like your phone's accelerometer data, to your laptop, and then you'd have to repackage it to fit Wekinator, but you'd have to repackage the OSC. But then you can basically send your accelerometer data to Wekinator, so then you can learn over that. So that's pretty neat, right? Those are all things that you can look into, and they're not super difficult to get off the ground, but if you have some ideas for inputs and you want to bounce them off me, please do. There's lots of other things. Quartz Composer is another popular framework for doing media art stuff. I've never used it, so I don't know too much about it. The Kinect, which we may have time to show. WebSockets, you could do stuff through WebSockets, get it online. There's I'm just telling you the examples that come with it. These ones, there's no examples for, but I bet would be really awesome. So, like, these are newer things. So, like, the Mayo sensor, you guys know that thing? It's like an armband that tracks like that's able, yeah, it tracks your muscles basically. So like you can associate hand gestures and get decent features from that. There's like the brain scanner things, you know, the OpenBCI makes brain scanners. Those are all like different inputs. You can just imagine data streams, weather.com could be a data stream, you could get features from that. Basically anything. Anything that's numbers. So that's good. Let's try to do some more examples while we have time and I can kind of just like make some funny things. Let's do, let's see how much we have, 20 minutes. Let's do a quick Ableton example, and we'll use, what should we use as the features? I could use the leap. Sorry? Yeah, the problem with is my leap, my leap. Let's just use Face Tracker just because it's already set up. So we're going to restart this. And here's what I'll do. I'm going to open up Ableton. I have a demo version. How many people use Ableton besides you? Yeah, just a couple. All right. So I'm going to go quick just because two people use it. But just to show you like the most basic, I don't even have a full version of this. Let's just make, okay, so I'm going to add, I basically do the same thing every time because I don't use Ableton. I'm going to put in a clip of Tabla just because it sounds great and the Dolac. right. Yeah, okay. And let's put in a audio effect. Let's put in a resonator. I love this LA preset. Yeah, okay. So now check this out. So Ableton doesn't take OSC by default. There's a little way that's tricky, but you can convert MIDI to OSC. So I made an application that basically does that for you. It's called Ableton OSC. So for those of you guys who are using it, you can download this. And I think this should work. Yeah. But I forget which one works by default. This one definitely works, so let me use this one. Wick and Ableton, yeah. Okay, so it loads. What's going on? Okay. Let's try this one. Sometimes, let's see what happens. It might have a port issue. Hang on a second. Amazing how quickly things break. I have an OSC issue. Why? This is all on. Yeah, I know I have my OSC, so I'm not sure what's going on here. But it might not be enough time to debug. Okay, but what I can do is though show you, because I've done this exact thing before, so I'll just show you the video. I don't know what's going on, I'll have to fix that. This is the life of sort of breaking software all the time. Okay, what I was going to show you is this, basically. So you see what's going on? I trained it on a whole bunch of face gestures. And then associated with a whole bunch of synthesizer parameters in Ableton. And so when I make different facial gestures, okay, so yeah, that's an example of using it with Ableton. I don't know why my software is not working. I'll have to fix that. It's probably some OSC thing. Let's see. I want to really quickly show you dynamic time warping, which is something that's part of Wackinator that Rebecca does a lot of. I haven't done so much of this myself, but it's really useful, so you guys might find it kind of cool. So what dynamic time warping is it's a way of doing classification But instead of using a feature vector, which is sort of stuck in time, it takes a sequence of features over some amount of time. So like you'll hold a record button that grabs a gesture, let's say, and then it classifies over that. So this will make more sense if I actually just demonstrate it. So let's open, we'll use the bark bands, I think should be really good. Bark extractor, yeah. So this is giving us, again, 25 of these. So we can like say a word, basically, and we might be able to do some basic like speech to text. So I haven't tried this before, so I don't know if this is gonna work, but let's try. Okay, so we'll say listening 640, and then this is sending 25. So 6448 sending 25 inputs that we can see here. And we'll do one output, and it's going to be a dynamic time warping. By the way, I've been blowing through these, but basically you can have all continuous, all classifiers, all dynamic. Those are just presets, but you can also do like a more complex. So you could do what's this? Yeah, you could do a custom, which lets you just add them one at a time, and you can mix and match different kinds of outputs. We'll just have, let's say, three. So this is going to set up one output, which has three classes. So we're doing classification. Okay, so here it is. And then basically this is one output, but it has three different classes. And we're going to record something to associate with each one. So let's see here. So the way you record is you basically hit the plus button. You hold the plus button. That will start recording, and then as soon as you turn it off, as soon as your finger comes off and it comes off, it stops recording. So basically, let's record a word. So I'm going to record the word hello, right? So that's what we're going to do. We're going to get these features. Hello. So I'll hit plus, and I'll say hello, and I'll stop. Hello. And now let's do another one. What's going on here? Oh, I see. This is not working I don't have that open sound. Yeah, let's grab open sound. This one. You just need this file, open sound control. .xmo, and you can put it in this. You can put it either in your. If you guys know how to use Macs, you can put it into your MSP externals, or you can just put it into the. In with the patch. So now it should work. Yeah, there it is. Now it's lit up. Okay, so that didn't work. So let's try it again. Okay. So. We'll go. Hello. Okay, so we got one example of hello. Let's do goodbye. Goodbye. And then ITP. ITP. Okay, so now this should run. Okay, so we go hello, hello, goodbye, ITP. Maybe it's not working so well, actually. maybe the bark coefficients aren't actually the best features, but let's see. Hello? Goodbye? Goodbye? It kind of seems to work. Maybe let's just try doing two classes. And let's not use the bark, but I've seen Rebecca use the MFCCs before, so I think maybe MFCCs are better. I don't know why.
Since the classification regression, you're using so many training examples, would you want to use more than one?
Yeah, that might be. It might just be that we need more than one. But let's just also simplify the problem and just have two classes, and we'll grab more examples. Let's still try with the outputs, but we'll have one. And it'll be dynamic time warping. We'll have just two. So Yeah, let's try that. And yeah, maybe we should just do a few more examples. So we'll say, how about hello and ITP? Hello. 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 ITP. 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 Okay, let's try that. Hello. Hello. ITP. ITP. All right, I'm not having as much success as Rebecca. we can see she has a good example of this on the calculator.
I think it like recognizes your voice. Perfect.
Yeah, maybe that also. I think she used the MFCCs, which is another thing that comes with.
In this demo, I'm going to show you how to. So, left.
Yeah, this is what should be happening, something like this. And then
then
what you get, what happens is it gives you an output.
Screen capture, but you'll see this go
it outputs the class. Like each time you try, it'll send you the class that it thinks it was. And you can associate it with actions.
Left.
Right. And actually, I want to say that just using the voice, this is like maybe the worst example to start with because it's a really complicated sequence. A better sequence might be something like a gesture. Like if we did this with a Kinect, it would probably be really good. So it would recognize gestures with the Kinect. But we don't really have time for that, so I'm not going to do that. But basically, just be aware of dynamic time warping. It lets you do sequences, so it'd be good for gesture stuff as well.
What do you like? Because it needs to view the whole thing over time. Is it only going to be at the tail end of your gesture that is going to classify it?
I'm actually not even sure where it is, where it's starting, or how it, I think it maybe just tries Windows and looks for one that's pretty good. I'm actually not super sure. I haven't done too much of this feature. If you look at the Cadence course, I think Rebecca spends a lot more time on it, so if you're interested in this feature, I would start there. Okay, let me just quickly, because we're running out of time, I want to kind of be concise I just want to, okay, maybe we'll show one more example, and I also want to mention, this notion of, Wekinator being a switchboard should make a lot more sense. You can see how we can sort of swap different inputs in and out, and I didn't even get to do, a really, let's see how easily we could do, okay. actually, I think. Yeah, this will take too long. So I'm gonna maybe make one before the next class and show you. But I was gonna the more complicated example that I was gonna make that would be kind of nice demo would be suppose that we were doing some classification. We could make a drum machine or something or like a sequencer, and then we can go between different presets in the sequencer. And play like let's say I have a kick drum and a snare and a hi-hat, and every time let's say we were doing the vocal recognition, if I go ITP, it would play a kick drum. If I go hello, it would play a snare drum. So you can see ways of creating different intermodal multimedia controllers for a drum machine or a sequencer or really cool creative performing applications like that. So that's what I would have made if we had more time, but we'll kind of have to start to wrap up. Just start to look at some more examples. There's more, of course. This is a big survey, and I'm going to include these in the notes. But you can see you could use Chuck, IFTT. I forget what this is. If this, then that. Yeah, I've never used it, so I don't know. Unity. People use Wekinator with Unity. Anything that takes OSC can work really well. Okay, so this is what I'm going to try to cram into the next 7 minutes. I want to show you really quickly, because at least one person's already asking about the Kinect 2 gesture. So I made an application based on OFX Learn, which classifies gestures. And I'm going to show you a highlight from it. This is from a project that I did recently. So it's basically time to a metronome. And every time the metronome, you'll see a dot in the left corner means it's recording. So when the red light goes on, it begins to record a gesture, and when the red light goes off, it stops, and it classifies that gesture. And we had 30 different categories that we classified, which have really funny names because of what the, it was an art piece. So. but basically, it's classifying these on the fly. Digital write, parentheses, upload, verify, low. So these are all different classes that we trained it on, and then it was able to classify these. So this is an application that I have that is working, and I made a tutorial on how to use it. So if you go, you can find this on Vimeo. So if you go to my Vimeo, there's a tutorial on this right here, which will explain how to use it. I think it's public.
This tutorial will show you how to use Connect to Gesture.
Yeah, so this is basically just a long tutorial on how to use this. Dissimilar. Okay, so like, we don't have to watch it, but basically, and all the software is online. So this is really good if you want to do classification of gestures. And it does pretty well. Like, we trained it on 30 classes. And it's using a Connect. It's actually using a Connect 2, but so that complicates it a little more. If you're interested in using this, let me know, because we'll have to talk about how to make arrangements if you don't have a Connect 2, because it's only set up for Connect 2 right now, but we can probably pretty quickly set it up for a Connect 1. Yeah?
Possibly, we have an e-lab for Connect 2 if someone
else. Oh, good, yeah. This particular software that I made is a little wonky because the Connect 2 only does skeleton tracking on Windows. So I'm actually running it from a Windows computer, which is then sending yet more OSC of the skeleton to the Mac computer, and then it does all the classification. But yeah, it's self-contained as long, but you do need a Windows computer, so that's kind of annoying. If you only can do this on like a Mac and have a Connect 1, then we can probably set it up without too much difficulty. It won't be as accurate though. So that's something to look out for. So yeah, I would have done this. I even brought a Connect here, but things just don't have enough time. Okay, so I intended to do like a 20 or something, 30 minute section in this, but somehow we got shuffled off. So I'm going to just send you some links that for some of this reading. In general, I want to try to make a little bit of time to talk about these things in class just because they're important. I hope that a few of you might latch onto these as project ideas to do some research into some things that all of us don't know about. But there's a lot of really interesting, and this is actually the first link is really good here, and I'll put these online today so you'll have these. But basically, like, a lot of links on sort of what are called critical algorithm studies is a really big list of papers and writing that has been done about algorithms and biases and accountability and like different intangible issues that are a little bit difficult for us to perceive because we're not used to, you know, like we've been seeing a lot of like robots in the news, and it's not clear who's responsible for them when they do things that we don't like. Things like that are all super important, and I'm hoping that some people are find some interest in that. So I have some list of things that we can study. This is kind of a joke, actually. I don't know if anyone managed to see this video. But basically, like, I don't know if anyone saw this from Robot Live. This is the one else. This is a joke. But if you saw this video a few weeks ago of, like, the Boston Dynamics robots, you guys see this? These humanoid robots, which are ridiculously good at walking and carrying things. But what's crazy about them is that, like, I don't know about you, but, like, when the guy starts to mess with it, I become a little sad for the robot. This gets really bad.
Oh.
So you guys have a little bit of empathy? Are you feeling just a little, you know? Like, if it starts to feel to us like if we perceive it as if we start to feel empathy for it, are people going to start to stick up for these robots? So
I think it's the fact that the action is performed by a human.
Maybe partially, yeah. Yeah, exactly. All right. What is a human, right? I don't know. but actually, someone made a really funny parody of this, basically. Like, they took the vocal track from an ASPCA
right now,
commercial.
Somewhere in America, there's an animal being beaten. And another being locked in a cage, alone. These scared, innocent animals don't realize there's any hope for a better life. At the ASPCA, we're committed to searching every dark corner to find them.
So basically, you get the idea. Yeah, it's funny, but like this kind of stuff might become really relevant soon. I mean, if we start to make these like humanoid robots, which people have, you know, if they're really able to communicate with us in some sense, we might start to feel empathy for them. And so, you know, will we start to sort of, will we begin to lobby for recognition and rights? Will they have rights and so on? These are all things that we might have to think about. The trolley problem is a really interesting thing. We'll maybe like set aside some time to talk about these next week, I hope. If we can make the time in between technical stuff. Okay, so just assignment. I just want to talk about the assignment real quick. So this is what I would like for you to do. I'd like for you, everyone, to experiment with Wekinator. And basically, I think we should really just stick to this right now. I would be open right now to if someone did. So pick one of these two, basically. I'm going to maybe say, just because we didn't have enough time to talk about these, that they're not part of it, but if you read through some of these, I'd be happy if you, like, if someone wanted to do this as an assignment, to basically write a page about some interesting topic and maybe present it next week, just talk about it for a couple of minutes. So that's one assignment. If people want to take that, then they'll be basically asked to just say a little bit about one of these topics. And I'm going to share these on the notes online. Another thing that you can do is basically to try to set up something with Wekinator, either one of the examples that we looked at today or like one of your own choosing. And know that, like, because this is just it doesn't have to be like something super complete, right? Like, you, if you're thinking about using Wekinator for a project at the end, then you can do something that's more sophisticated. But like for now, just if you can get it up and running, that will really start to jog the brain about, you know, different project ideas. And so yeah, try to set up Wekinator. Send me emails if you're having any difficulty. And that's about all. So I'm going to post these online the same way that I posted the lecture last week, and these notes and the links, and start playing with Wekinator. Send me some questions if you have any, and I'll see you next week. And by the way, I'm sticking around for the next hour or so. Like, we can consider this an impromptu office hours, and for the rest of the weeks we'll figure it out as we go. But if anyone wants to hang out or talk Wekinator, talk other stuff, I'll hang out here. Unless this room being used for the next? Oh, okay. In that case, like at that point, maybe I'll leave. But okay, we'll turn off the recording now. Thanks, everybody. See you next week.